Welcome to the BK Q&A, where we make you mad about Sonic Cannon. I'm your host, Ian Flynn, the Bumble King, and joining me as always is the king of queries, Kyle JCRB Krause.
We do make people mad about Sonic Cannon. I'm sorry to say, we don't control what's canon and what's not. You're going to have to take that up with Sega, but, you know, hey, it's still, it's pretty funny.
I'm dreading the day when, you know, things change on their end and everything that I have established on this show is no longer accurate. And they're going to start coming out of the wormwood saying, you said they said this. And it's like, yeah, and it changes, guys.
Yeah. Sorry.
Remember when the extended universe of Star Wars was semi-canon and then they threw it all out? Companies change things.
Yes. And it's not the fault of the person doing the writing.
So,
yeah.
Also, I have a quick question for you, Kyle.
Yeah.
Before we get into the show. Why do we have things?
I don't know.
Why do we want to own houses and living spaces that must be cleaned, that tax us so that our voices are nearly gone when we have to do a show?
In the broadest sense
of the question, you see.
Well, I mean, humans desire shelter. That's kind of a basic necessity of living, or basic,
stupid,
like a basic tenant, a basic tenant of what most people want in life. I don't know how to describe it exactly. It's science. That's what it is. Science. That's why. That's how you can explain it all. It's science.
Okay.
But also, yeah, things, having things, yeah, it's a big pain. It's like George Carlin said, it's everyone's got their own little pile of stuff. And when you go up in an airplane, you can look down and you see everyone's little piles of stuff everywhere. They're all over the place.
Pretty much. So that's my roundabout way of apologizing to you, dear listeners, for sounding like I tried to eat a fireplace. It's... I'll try to get through the show, but for now, Kyle, tell the lovely people how they can get their question answered on the show.
Yes. Well, let's talk over the rules and everything for Q&A. First of all, you can ask your questions. You can email us at bumblecast@yahoo.com. Hit us up on Twitter at BumbleKast. You can also donate to us on Ko-fi. That's ko-fi.com/BumbleKast. It's two coffees there, so $6. And in the YouTube comments on any of our videos, that's any video. Yes, I see them all in our comment feed. Or you can also leave a comment or message via Patreon or in the Q&A Discord channel if you happen to be a patron and have access to the Discord. Keep in mind that if your question's been answered within the last few episodes, is over on the FAQ at BumbleKing.com, or is about past Sonic plans that will be covered in Lost Hedgehog Tales, then we likely won't be answering it. If your question hasn't been answered in a while, check those places. Or also understand that we have a considerable queue, and it's been great having so much, especially recently, having so much of your... questions and having so much interaction with everybody. It's been awesome, but do keep in mind, we get a lot of questions now. And we're even toying with having to integrate a queue for the priority Q&A because there's so many of you guys in the Discord asking your questions, and we love that, but it's a lot. So if Ian is continues having the issues that he has with his voice, we may have to cap it off at a certain number of questions per episode for priority Q&A and then go from there. So you may have to wait an episode or two to get your questions answered, even if you're priority. We apologize. We're trying our best, but we will do what we can do for you guys. So that being said, let's go ahead and get into the first question, the priority Q&A. This one comes from Off, or AWF, If Naugus' magic turned Bunny's cybernetic limbs organic and turned nanite grass into real grass, as well as anything else it could have done that we never got to see due to the cancellation, wink wink, hashtag no smile, could Naugus' magic have cured the metal virus? If you had used metal virus idea in the Archie comics, is this an event we could have eventually seen play out?
Probably not. This is a whole lot of who knows, because I never got to formally pitch metal virus in the Archie books. But by that point, I planned to have Naugus dead. In retrospect, I probably would have been kicking myself because that would have been an easy out, because I didn't really have an end plan because I hadn't really pitched the story yet. So I have no idea how it would have played out in that hypothetical scenario, but not Naugus. I was going to kill him off.
Well then, boy, that's going to get the people going, Ian. See what you've done? It's awesome. Keep it up.
Sorry, I got to limit the banter.
It's fine. It's fine. Don't worry about it. Scruffymatt is up next. One of my favorite parts of IDW Sonic number 29 was that Eggman got taken down by Froggy. I laughed so hard at that. That said, I was a little disappointed we didn't actually get to see Eggman finally getting a taste of his own medicine. My question is, in previous drafts of this issue script, was there ever a version where we would have gotten to see Eggman fully transformed into a zombot? What about Amy, Tails, and Espio?
No, just because at that point we'd seen so many people transform that the transformation itself wasn't really that interesting. It's more of a kind of collector's list at that point. The horror of the infection spreading had already been well established at this point. The tension of the story was the ticking clock. You know, everyone's falling. Angel Island is getting overrun. Zavok is being a super jerk. Sonic is literally on his last molecule of uninfected self. So with only 20 pages to work with, the priority went to the excitement of that last minute turnaround with Supersonic instead of seeing more people turn. Because at that point, you know what's going to happen. And by putting it off screen, it almost has a Hitchcockian aspect where you know it's happening, but you don't see it, and that somehow makes it worse.
All right, next one comes from Afro Luffy X. One missed opportunity that I thought in the Zombot story arc are Zombots fusing with one another to form grotesque and monster versions of themselves. Was this idea strapped, I assume they mean scrapped, during the planning stages of the arc?
Never on the table, because that wasn't really what the metal virus did. It turned them into robot zombies. It didn't turn them into goo monsters that could fuse and smush. Now, there was a scene where Tumble gets smashed pretty badly. And the funny thing there was that the note I got back on it was, that's too harsh. Rein it back in. It's like, yeah, fair enough. We shouldn't have any kind of real body horror beyond just the infection. And then the arc came in and he got really seriously smushed. So, eh. So it goes. But no, fusions of zombie people was never on the table.
All right. Next question comes from TKOS. I hope this question doesn't sound like it's LHT related. I remember toward the end of Enerjack Reborn that Scourge had to supercharge a warp ring with the Master Emerald in order to travel from Mobius Prime to Moebius. Moebius, is that what it's called? I'm going to call it Moebius.
It's technically pronounced the same way.
That's I know it's pronounced the same way, but the only way to differentiate between the two in speaking is to call it Moebius. This warp ring had a noticeable glow to it in order to show that it was indeed supercharged. Later on, however, in Scourge Lockdown, Fiona and the Destructics travel from Mobius Prime to the Cosmic Interstate and later from the No Zone to Moebius. Yet the warp ring they had looked normal and didn't have a glow or anything to indicate that it is supercharged with anything. So I guess my question is, how were the Destructics able to travel outside of Mobius Prime with what appears to be a normal warp ring? And at the risk of sounding like a double question, whatever happened to Scourge's supercharged warp ring? Basically, I'm just asking for some clarification on the warp rings. Thanks!
This is going to sound like a total cop-out, but this is legit. Moving from two completely separate dimensions required more oomph. That's why he needed the supercharged ring. But the Cosmic Interstate interconnects all zones, and the No Zone runs through all zones. Therefore, it is easier to make a dimensional breach between those areas and a singular dimension than going from one dimension to another dimension. The equivalent would be, you know, going immediately from one house to another versus going outside, walking down the sidewalk, and entering the other house. As for the supercharged ring, gosh, it's been so long. But you can kind of assume that it either is lost because Scourge is not the brightest bulb in the chandelier, or maybe Miles squirreled it away for his own personal arsenal and, you know, just didn't happen to tell anybody that he did that. Maybe Scourge had it in his pocket this whole time and it got confiscated by the zone cops. Maybe it lost its charge. Maybe I forgot about it while writing. No, no, of course not. Never that.
Okie dokie. Next up, Andrew D. You've mentioned multiple times certain Sonic games being non-canon. Do you know a list of all the games that are canon and non-canon?
I don't have, like, the list from on high of what is canon and what is not. It's more of a, you know, what have I run into here and there. A handful of things that I know are not. The original Chaotix isn't considered part of it, which is a shame. Sonic Chronicles is not considered one. I'm pretty sure the Olympic series is considered not part of it.
I would say most spinoffs probably really aren't.
Yeah. More or less, unless Sonic Team had a direct hand in it, you can probably say it's not part. Although I was surprised when Sonic R was considered canon. So I don't know. It could be that this list changes depending on who I'm asking at the time.
Mm-hmm. Next one is from Diane W. Team Dark are not friends and are not affiliated with Gun in the modern games and IDW Comics, which brings me to this question. Is Shadow still carrying out Maria's wish to protect humanity and give them a chance to be happy? Or does he not care about Maria or her wish because he hates humanity, according to Sega? Sorry if I sounded a bit cynical there. It's just I'm still bothered by Sega's ideal characterization of Shadow.
Well, now, I don't know where the "so he hates humanity" came from. I think he's just generally cranky with everybody. But
I mean, that sounds like Shadow.
The impression I got, and this is, take this with a grain of salt, but the impression I got was that coming out of Shadow the Hedgehog, it was no longer that he was being ruled by Maria's dying wish, is that he was going to forge his own path. He had finally identified who he was, and he was going to move forward in his own direction, which is a fine evolution of the character. You can kind of see that as it goes into Sonic 06, where, you know, even though he is... It's kind of like Christ's temptation on the hill between him and Mephiles, complete with the crucifixion imagery. Good night. It's freaking Sonic. Anyway, with Mephiles saying, you know, humanity will turn against you at the drop of a hat, and Shadow says, I don't care. I'm still going to do things my way. I think that's the direction they're going with him right now.
All right. Next up, we have two questions from our friends who donated to us at Ko-fi. Very lovely people. First up, we have Mechanist Gamma. I've got a question when it comes to Ian's views on the Sonic timeline. With Team Sonic Racing, does it come before or after Sonic Forces? If it's after, will Team Sonic Racing be referenced at any point in IDW's taking place between stories?
I think you could make a case for it coming at either point, really. I also think you probably shouldn't think too hard about its placement in the canon, but in terms of folding it into IDW's overall narrative, I don't have any plans to do so, primarily because Sega prefers that we don't directly reference the games. The references that we have made have been either small concessions or me being a little tricksy in my wording here and there, but don't expect us to make an effort to acknowledge it anytime soon.
And next up, we got one from Saturn Flicky. The JPSA1 guides say Tikal's era was 3,000 years ago. Battle says Emerald is 4,000 years old. Chronicles says both were 4,000 years ago. When you say Chronicles is non-canon, Is that the official word from Sega? Should its timeline change and Echidna Geizoid connection be disregarded? I always am not 100% sure how to pronounce Geizoid or Geizoid, whatever.
I say Gizoid, but that Gizoid, could be wrong.
Okay. Anyway, answer the question.
Yeah, official word is Chronicles is non-canon. You can ignore all of it, including the connection between the Gizoids and the Echidnas. Whether there will be a connection between them at some point, that is up to Sega if they decide to revisit the idea. But for now, you can take T'Kall's civilization being in 3,000 years ago, and whoever predated them by another 1,000 years built Emerald. And that's as far as we know for sure.
And our last question. This one comes from Blue Title Gamer. Is there a video game franchise you would like to see get a comic series and get to write for?
Skies of Arcadia.
Well, that's the obvious, easy one.
There were a few that Archie pitched to Nintendo back in the day, and I really wish I had gotten to do the Metroid series comic. I thought I could do some fun with that. And not to go into too much detail, because I don't want to throw a wrench into potential future things, but I was on tap to do a Metal Gear book last year, I think, and then it fell through. But the premise was that they would be stories that kind of filled in the gaps between games. And the first story pitched was one that would bridge Metal Gear Solid 5 and the original Metal Gear, showing how Venom Snake went full villain and assembled his group that Solid Snake takes out. And I was really excited about getting, you know, elbow deep in Metal Gear lore and putting it together, and then it fell apart. So that was a lot of research and headaches for nothing.
Metal Gear.
I know exactly how I want to do a Star Fox story. I don't know if I would be allowed to tell it the way I want to, but I am super hyper nerdy, ready to do that. Just let me off the leash. Let me go nuts with it. And pretty much, if you're out there and you've got a video game series that has the inklings of a story and are looking to do some kind of narrative transference between them, call me up. I will be your alchemist. I will change that from one medium to another. It's what I do. It's what I've done for Sonic. It's what I did for Mega Man. It's what I'm currently doing for the Rivals of Aether series. I may be pigeonholed, but it's a nice hole to be pigeoned into.
Inkling, you say, huh? How about Splatoon?
Yeah.
You can do something with Splatoon.
Blue Title Gamer has a question for you, sir.
Uh-oh.
Kyle, have you ever played any games from Suda51, such as Killer7 and No More Heroes, for a few examples? They're cult classics, and while they may not be for everyone, I feel they are worth at least giving a look. There's nothing else quite like a Suda game.
That's true. Let's see. The one I have played is Lollipop Chainsaw. And I looked this up beforehand because I'm like, I don't think I have played any of them. And then I saw Lollipop Chainsaw, and I'm like, oh, yeah. I guess that is a Suda game. So, yeah, I liked Lollipop Chainsaw. It was very silly, very stupid, but a lot of fun. And I did enjoy that one. I've not played No More Heroes or Killer7. They're both on my list, in a sense. Killer7, I know, I've known since it was, like, GameCube fresh. So, like, I've been hearing about that game for nearly two decades at this point. So it's like, okay, maybe I should eventually get around to at least playing that one. And I've heard a lot of good things about No More Heroes, except for the most recent one, but that's another story. So yeah, I'm interested in playing some more of them, but I've played at least one. So I have a passing familiarity with Suda51, which is an interesting name, but you know what? It's cool. These eccentric developers, they always have fun nicknames. I'm into it. So,
I've played Killer7, and it's weird.
Yeah,
it's an interesting experience, and it walks that fine line of am I too stupid to understand this? Or is this so far its own up its own butt that it doesn't know what it's trying to say? You can't really tell. Is it symbolism or is it just madness? I don't know. But it was an interesting experience. I wouldn't mind going through it again at some point.
Yeah, Lollipop Chainsaw is just straight up stupid cheesecake silliness. It's dumb. It's the kind of thing I get into because it's so silly. Like Metal Wolf Chaos, you know? Just stupid that it loops back around into being brilliant again. All right, let's get into the standard Q&A. Here's one from Papa Dreepopolis. Can we get you saying the various names and terms in Drogoon out loud to make pronunciation clear? Any terms and names you can think might be relevant to make clear? Although the ones that jumped to me when I binge read recently were, you would have to say these, Ian. Were various suffixes for the realms. Yes, go ahead.
What an attractive and intelligent question. I like this one. I mean, that's one thing that I was kind of grappling with when I was composing Drogoon is, you know, it's a fantasy series, and fantasy series have funny terms and names and such, but I didn't want to get too far afield so that it was too dense, too obtuse to approach, you know? Don't want to throw in too many apostrophes between letters to break up words so they look all mythical and whatnot. So basically everything in Drogoon is a corruption of a real word, that so it feels familiar enough with still looking somewhat foreign. My bottom of the barrel etymology is being put into play here. So there's at least the tiniest foundation of legitimacy to this, just enough that it almost seems credible. Anyway, I'll run down the list of races. Excuse me. I hate that term. Run down the list of species for this. We have the Age, the Droth, the Nerman, the Hume, the Orkun, the Drogon themselves, of course, and then the Enchanti. And then all of their realms have the suffix Heim. So the Age are from Ageheim, Droth are from Drothheim, Hume from Humeheim, etc., etc., etc. Within the principal cast, we have Wind Tavan. The tall Age fellow is Foren. The Droth pilot is Jobun. And then the incredibly adorable little girl is Lissy, but her full name is Indelis Infantum. And just quick shout out to Adam Bryce Thomas, who has rendered them all phenomenally and has made Lissy just the scene-stealing cutest thing ever. I mean, that was her point. She's supposed to be weapons-grade adorable, but man, does he freaking nail it. I guess another thing off the top of my head is the unifying government for the realms is Galaxant. And I think that should get you through the basics of the series.
All right, next question is from Exidel. Question for later. Are there any elements, characters, or plot devices from Archie, your faves Relic or Eclipse, the concept of egg bosses, etc., that are on the table for future use in IDW, or does Sega have a strict no-rehash rule when it comes to elements from past comics? Well, your question may be for later, but we're answering it now, so.
Sega in general doesn't seem to like to reference older incarnations of material, and I believe that the Archie material is in some kind of legal conundrum. I'm not particularly sure. But overall, yes, all the Archie stuff is off the table for the foreseeable future. If IDW were to maybe one day get the reprint rights, at least for the post-reboot stuff, then I might kind of, you know, lean in on the editor's door and say, so maybe could we reinvent a character too? Yeah, Warp Ring opens up and they just fall into the new storyline. Maybe, possibly, please. But I'm not holding my breath waiting for that, and neither should you. For now, IDW Sonic is pure, distilled, unsweetened IDW Sonic.
And next up, we got one from Nick G. Just finished reading the Sonic and Mega Man crossover comics you wrote, and it was amazing. But it did make me think, why weren't Resident Evil and Devil May Cry characters among the cameos? There would be tame enough ways to introduce the characters, and from then on, they'd be fighting robots. Was it a licensing issue? They're just so big in terms of Capcom properties that their omission baffles me.
They are big, but I wanted to aim for franchises that, in general, felt more in theme with each other and had more of a visual look to each other. I mean, in Super and Ghouls and Ghosts, you have Arthur fighting various forms of demons and such, but they're very cartoony demons. They're not like the infected out of Resident Evil, let's say. Dante probably would have fit in terms of his bombastic attitude and such, but I may be wrong, but I think Worlds Unite might have come out around the time they attempted the redo with the Devil May Cry series, and we got the short-haired Dante that everybody hated, and that might have played a factor into it. Part of it, too, is I wanted to have, where I could, a little bit of duality between franchises, you know, an RPG here, an RPG there, and, I mean, I guess I maybe could have done House of the Dead or Virtua Cop to link up with Resident Evil, but, again, that's getting a little bit outside of colorful cartoon mascot territory. You dig me?
Sure.
The closest I was, I mean, you can make an argument for a lot of these and where they could work and where they couldn't. And you're probably right, but it was just a matter of what we had access to, how much time we had, and what would take the least amount of effort to make fit within the visual theme. Like taking the Resident Evil folks and making them look like they sync up with the cartoony people from Skies of Arcadia would have been an undertaking in and of itself, let alone with all these other franchises. Street Fighter was a little easier because they are very cartoony in their proportions by default, and they were already kind of hardwired into the story. I didn't get a choice on Street Fighter. They were in there whether I wanted them or not. So there's a long list of various franchises that I would have loved to throw in there. I tried to find a place to throw Rystar in there, but it's like, there's not enough room. And really, out of all the franchises, does he really need a place in there? No, I guess not. I mean, yeah, Alex Kidd kind of fell into obscurity by that point, too. But come on, he was the original Sega mascot. He had to show up.
He did.
I had to put that Sonic Alex Kidd moment in there.
Oh, man.
This is required by the laws of the universe.
That's my favorite moment of Worlds Unite, is the meeting of Alex Kidd and Sonic. I don't know why. I don't know why. It just made me so happy to see that.
I mean, Worlds Unite was a bit of a mess. We've covered this, but
yeah,
I hope that at least the last third had at least one moment of, oh boy, this is fun.
Yep.
For somebody out there.
That's the thing. It's full of a ton of fantastic moments. May not have necessarily coalesced and came together quite the way you had hoped, but you know, there's a little something in it for everybody, I think. There's little things here and there that are fun. So I'm just disappointed we never got to see the very polygonal announcer guy from Virtua Racing. Never got the driver and his girlfriend from Outrun. Never got the Hornet from Daytona USA. No one thought to put an F-14 in there because we need some afterburner. You know that? Nobody put anything I wanted in there. What's up, man? What's up with that? Why'd you leave out all these racing games with these amazing characters that everybody cares about and loves? I mean, people do love the Hornet, but, you know, that's like the only thing. Could have been an anthropomorphic car. Like, I mean, the Hornet stands up and fights in Fighters Mega Mix. Could put it in
tell
there. Yeah, I'm kidding. Don't do that.
No. You get everybody to come back to the table for a director's cut, and I'll add in a scene where Phoenix Wright comes in driving the Hornet. does donut peel out on Sigma's face yelling objection.
You have to have Ryo from Shenmue come in on the in an Outrun arcade cabinet, driving it in an Outrun arcade cabinet, you know, just like he does in All-Stars Racing Transformed.
He just pulls up in the middle of the fight and says, can any of you tell me where the sailors are?
Yeah.
Everyone just kind of looks at him and goes, never mind, drives off.
yep. There we go. Perfect. Cut, print, make it happen. Here we go. We got one last question here from LT. Wait. Is Mutsuki a Labrador? Is he Chuck's lab assistant / lab assistant?
Ew. No, Mutsuki, true to his name, is a mutt. But that makes him good at mutt-y-tasking.
Oh, wow. You went there.
I did.
Wow. Incredible. I guess that's it. I mean, yeah, that's it. He doesn't really look like a Labrador. I don't know where they got that one from, but sure.
Hey, you got to go for the dog jokes so that you can.
I know. All right, well, that's going to do it for this edition of the BumbleKast, I think. Is there anything we need to get to before I get to the lovely supporter shout-outs, Ian?
Not that I can think of. Read that long list of beautiful people.
All righty. Why did I close it? What am I doing with my life? I'm serious. Why did I close it? I left it open specifically so I could read it, and it's closed. All right, here we go. Big shout out and huge thanks to Daniel H., Salute Your Cat, Robotnik Holmes, Scorched Freedom, Off, Alex M., Jonathan D., Sony, Blue Title Gamer, Koopaling Crew, Andrew D., Papa Dreepopolis, Scruffymatt, Chris A., John B., Diane W., James K., Jennifer R., Torchbound, Jennifer H., Lisa M., Chaos Universe, Sonic Legacy, Lauren W., Owen B., Preston M., Yami M., Justin S., Silly String, Tucaro, Lee HK, Overthinking Films, Don B., John M., Chavel, Mike B., Duiz Dizdin, Samuel P., Alex P., Justin G., Dave M., Sam Cybercat, and Final Neil. Also, big thanks to the two folks who sent us a question on Ko-fi most recently, Mechanist Gamma and Saturn Flicky. Thank you guys very much. Where can the people find you at, Ian, after the show's over?
Head over to my website, BumbleKing.com, that has links to my portfolio, my release schedule, and just about anything related to me. You can find me on Twitter at IanFlynnBKC, and you can read Drogoon for yourself for free over at Drogoon.com. We're also featured on Webtoon, which has a long link name that I can't read over this. It'd be ridiculous, but the link is off of Drogoon.com. We require a minimum of 1,000 prescribers. We require a minimum of 1,000 subscribers before we can apply to be one of their ad affiliates, and that would help Adam and I get by a little more and focus a little more on the book itself. So if you use Webtoon, if you would be so kind as to subscribe, you don't even have to read. That's okay. Just hit the button for me, and it would help us out a lot. Kyle, where can they find you after they've subscribed to us?
You can hit me up on Twitter at KyleJCRB. You can also head on over to kngi.org. That's the home of Nitro Game Injection, my other show, which you can listen to streaming live on Mondays at 7 p.m. Eastern Time. You can also find all the archived episodes of that show, as well as the BumbleKast and many other shows over at kngi.org. If you're into video game music, remixes, covers, arrangements, fan-created stuff, when it comes to VGM, then be sure to check out NGI. That's what the whole show's all about. And you can also find MP3 downloadable podcasts for the BumbleKast over there as well. So if you're interested in subscribing to the podcast audio version, you can do that over there.
You can follow and contact the show on Twitter at BumbleKast. BumbleKast@yahoo.com and listen to us on Apple Podcasts, Google Play, Spotify, Amazon Music, Audible, YouTube, and KNGI.org.
Yep, we got a few new ones in there. Also working on hopefully maybe getting it up on Pandora as well. So be sure to keep an eye out for that. So, but if you use Amazon Music or Audible, I believe if they have not already, they'll be launching podcast sections soon. So keep an eye out for that. I've already submitted it, so hopefully it will show up there when they do launch those too. So don't forget to also check out the store at shop.spreadshirt.com/bumblestore, where you can buy some Bumble items that are decked out with Bumble logos and our Bumble faces. So there you go. Go get them.
You can also watch us stream every Sunday night around 10 p.m. Eastern Time on twitch.tv/BumbleKastGaming. We also stream irregularly throughout the week, so follow us on Twitter at BumbleKast to see what our release schedule is and what we're doing and if we're doing.
Yep. Keep an eye out, and we'll let you know what's going on. So that's it.
Yep, that'll wrap us up for this week. We'll see you next week with more questions and answers. Till then, be good to yourselves and to each other.
See you next time.
Read what's on the screen, stupid.
I know, I feel.
We just watched the Pirates of the Caribbean movies again.
All five or just the first three?
No, there's only three, Kyle. What are you talking
okay,
about?
Okay, just checking.
And, you know, I can't really do my usual guffaw. And so Lee says, you're laughing like Davy Jones. And I said, don't tempt me. Don't tempt me. And then she said something else snarky. And I just had to go into character with the... Freaking love that movie. I mean, she's not wrong. It does sound like that, but...
Yeah. Yep.
Do you feel asthma?
Do you feel asthma? Yeah, I feel it all the time. Well, not so much anymore, but I used to.
Do you feel the cold collapse of your lungs as you try to do a squid pirate voice?
Yeah, Ian.
That's coming along a lot easier. I should have done the whole show maybe as Jamie
just
Jones.
Maybe you should just talk like Jamie Jones all the time.
Maybe that's welcome to the BumbleKast. I'm your host, Davy Jones, and I don't fear your questions.
Everyone in that movie talks funny.
You've been listening to the BumbleKast, a co-production of BumbleKing Comics and the KNGI Network. Original theme music composed by Ken Coda Snyder. Remixed intro by T-Lopes. Find out more information, along with podcast feeder links, MP3 downloads, and more at BumbleKing.com and KNGI.org.
That's it. I can feel it running out.
You're done. Yeah. Get out of here.
It's like watching a balloon deflate.
No, Ian, shut up. Get out of here.